welcome to this week's presentation for the Great Stone Viaduct Society Winter Lecture Series. You know, you sometimes talk to people via the internet, and you feel like you know them, but you've never met them. Well, that's kind of like it is tonight for Nick Friday, because when the Great Stone Viaduct Society set up our very first presentation here at the Bel Air Public Library, I believe it was probably 5 years ago. We did this by internet, and we had a very successful turnout, but tonight is the first time that I've actually gotten to meet Nick. Why is Nick here? Nick is here because there was a man that hailed from Wheeling, West Virginia, that went to Binghamton, New York, that went to Charleston, West Virginia, by the name of J.J. Young, Jr. And he was a railroad photographer phenom. He took some of the most fantastic photographs of the steam and diesel area. And what's particularly important is that he did it right here in the Ohio Valley, in and around the Wheeling area. So after J.J. passed, his widow wanted to see something done, and she donated the negatives to the West Virginia archives, where they are all today. And we're talking about how many hundreds, thousands?
It's around 10,000.
Around 10,000 negatives of photographs that J.J. took. I was one of those fortunate people who got to actually meet and sit with and have a hamburger with J.J. Young before he passed. He was a wonderful storyteller, and the photographs that he took also tell a story. And Nick is to be complimented because he put together the book, which you see there on the front table. Nick's been the curator of the John W. Barriger III National Railroad Library since 2012. He holds a Bachelor of Arts degree in history from the University of Maryland, Baltimore County, as well as a master's degree in 19th century United States history from that same institution. He also holds a master's in library and information sciences from Drexel University. He's worked in government record facilities, including the NASA Center for Aerospace Information. But his real passion has been photographs and railroad history. And he came, he was the archivist for the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad Historical Society, still is. So at this time, I would like to introduce Nick, as Nick introduces to you J.J. Young and some of the many wonderful photographs that tell a story almost as good as J.J. can tell.
All right, it works. Hi, I'm Nick Fry. And I have to admit, I did a lot of work on this book, but really, this could not have happened without the help of a lot of people, particularly Greg Smith, who unfortunately was not able to join us tonight from Baltimore, and Liz Young, who still lives in Charleston, and is the copyright holder, actually, of all the images that we have from the State Archives. If you were at the talk in Wheeling over the summer, act surprised. If not, I hope you'll enjoy this. We're going to talk about the journey that we went through to create this book. This was a long process. It took about 8 years, mainly because everybody involved had other jobs, and we could only work on it bit by bit by bit. And finally, when we had a manuscript ready, it was surprisingly quick for West Virginia University Press to say, J.J. Young, State Archives? Okay. I was expecting to have to fight more with them. I've heard stories of colleagues who shop a manuscript around to many, many, many publishers and get no's. And we were really surprised when the first place we went to said, sure. And I just kind of sitting at my desk and the yes email saying, well, this is really on. So we'll talk about the journey to create the book. J.J. Young, if you don't know who he was best described as a character. He was born in 1929 in Wheeling, West Virginia, and lived in Wheeling, Binghamton, or Charleston throughout his life and never had a driver's license. He traversed this country through the assistance of friends and fellow rail fans, and occasionally the good offices of various railroads, sometimes to his detriment. There's a story that Liz told me one of the first times I met her, and this was about a Thanksgiving in the Young family household, and a young J.J. Was there, and very, very into trains. He already started taking pictures, so we're looking at the late 30s, early 40s, and it's Thanksgiving Day. The turkey is going to go in the oven, and his mother's out of salt. Now, there's one store in Wheeling open on Thanksgiving Day that has salt, and his mom is in the middle of making Thanksgiving dinner. And J.J., being the oldest child, is sent out to get salt. So he goes out in the morning, and the store's not open yet. So J.J. does what J.J. likes to do, which is saunter over to the B&O Railroad Yard and kill some time before the store opens. And at this point, even at this young age, the crews knew who he was. And he had his camera, and they said, what's up, J.J., you know? And he said, what was he doing? He said, well, the store's not going to open for a while. You want to ride with us? We're going to go up to Pittsburgh and back. Now, most children, I hope, would have been taught by their parents or had the self-control to say, no, no, my mother is counting on me. I must stay here outside in the cold and wait for the store to open. J.J. said, sure. And he went to Pittsburgh. And he gets to Pittsburgh, and he's hanging around that yard. He's going to wait for the train to come back from Wheeling, and he meets another crew, and they say, oh, well, we're going up to Buffalo. You want to go? J.J. said, sure. And he went to Buffalo. Well, at this point, it's quite late in the day. Thanksgiving has almost come and gone. And J.J. decides it's probably a good idea to call home. He calls home. His mother is somewhat panicked and says, where are you? He says, I'm in Buffalo. And according to Liz, who got this from J.J. himself, his mother didn't say anything, but there was an audible sigh, and she hung up the phone. And at that point, J.J. knew he was probably in a small amount of trouble. So he got back on a train, came back to Pittsburgh, came back to Wheeling, and his father was waiting for him at the station. And as J.J. says, he kicked his butt all the way back to the family home, and he didn't sit down for about, oh, the rest of the Thanksgiving weekend. So that's the kind of person that J.J. was. He was very much into trains. He was, fortunately for my personal bias for railroads, I'm a B&O guy, he had the best relationship with the B&O Railroad. In fact, Mr. Sell, who was the division superintendent in Wheeling one time, called J.J. up to his office. And J.J. thought, you know, what have I done to get the attention of the division superintendent? Generally, when division superintendents point you out for anything, this is not a good sign, particularly if they call you to the office. And he said, young man, I noticed you walk around the yard with that camera. He says, yes, sir. I notice you're actually really careful. I've watched rail fans. You're one of the most aware and particular rail fans, photographers I've ever seen. You make sure you're doing everything safely around here. He said, yes, sir. He says, I appreciate that. And he hands him a pass, good for anywhere on the Wheeling Division. He can get in the cabs of locomotives. And if anybody has a problem with it, he just has to show the pass and say, Mr. Sell said I could be here. And he used it. And he photographed the Dickens out of the Wheeling Division and other divisions. Usually Mr. Sell's work was good enough to get you on the adjacent divisions. And at the State Archives, there are many, many, many photographs inside the cabs of locomotives, passenger trains that would not have been possible without this pass. And if you have a chance to go down to Charleston and look at the collection, I highly recommend it. If you'd like to work on the second book, you're more than welcome to. I'm done. 8 years is enough. So after that kind of little story about JJ, we'll go ahead and dive into how I got involved and how this book came to be. In 2004, I was the newly minted archivist of the B&O Railroad Historical Society. I'd only had the job for about 2 years. I was still in grad school, and we were getting the occasional email. And I got an email from the State Archives of West Virginia. Now, usually when someplace like that emails me, I think, well, they probably meant the museum, and they messed up. So I wrote back and said, you mean the museum? They said, no, we tried the museum. They said to contact you. Okay. And they talked about what their problem was. This was an archivist there named Deborah Basham. She said, we have J.J. Young's photograph collection. Now, J.J. had just died that year, 2004. It was either 04 or 07. I'm getting fuzzy on dates, partially because I've been in a car for 10 hours. And they had received his collection per his will. His collection was split up. The New York photographs went to his son, who lives in upstate New York. The West Virginia photographs went to the State Archives. His wife retains the copyright. However, JJ took his captions with him when he left us. So they had thousands and thousands and thousands of wonderful black and white photographs and no references to what they were. So not being railroad people, they said, where can we get a bunch of railroad people for cheap to come down and help us? And that's where they came to the B&O Historical Society. So we started gathering informally groups of people to go down to Charleston on our dime, on our own dime, to start reviewing the collection. We started with, fortunately they had made copy prints of all the negatives they had, and that's what they originally were donated, all the negatives. So we were working off copy prints, so they all had some kind of identification, and we wrote down on spreadsheets what everything was to the best of our knowledge. This process took about 5 years. And this is just one of the trips. Now we also got to meet Liz Young, who's in the fuchsia sweater there. And we got to talk with Liz. I got to know Liz really well. And she said, you know, there's never been a book about JJ. JJ was going to do a book and then he passed away. He never got it finished. But I'd really love to see something about that. And we were kind of, you know, photo books, if you don't do them right, you're stuck with a lot of books that didn't sell. So you have to see, is there an audience for it? And the first thing we wanted to do was test things out at the Historical Society. So we worked with Liz, we worked with the State Archives, and we came up with the 2007 calendar, which did very well. It was a black and white calendar. We ran it in conjunction with our color calendar. And it was kind of a rather quick and dirty put together project where we pulled images from the State Archives collection, did the captions, and put them out in the calendar form. And that was enough interest to say that the book was viable. So now we had to do a book. And at that point, we started doing more and more trips. One thing I have learned, that if I'm going to Wheeling, or I'm going to Charleston, West Virginia, anytime between December 21st and March 21st, I will inevitably pick the weekend where it's going to snow. It was like clockwork. And there was one, actually, that great story. Greg Smith and I were driving back, and we had been looking at this lake effect snowstorm coming in, and it was going to hit Morgantown. We had to go through Morgantown to go back to Baltimore. And we left early, and we thought, all right, we can outrun this. We're going to be perfect. This is going to be great. So we get to Clarksburg. We have dinner. We're looking at the radar. Everything looks good. We get to Morgantown. Fill up the car. We're in a Ford Focus right now. And we start going up the mountain to go east, and we start seeing little flakes. And I think, we're just outrunning it. I was wrong. That wasn't the front end of the storm. That was the back end of the storm. And we drove right into it. And then I saw the car the next morning, and it was covered in road salt. So from now on, Greg has said he will never drive to Charleston with me, because every time we've been there, it snowed, and snowed significantly. Which is really weird, because now I'm here in Bel Air, and I'm wearing a golf shirt. It's 60 degrees, so go figure. So Greg and Liz and I start working on this project with the assistance of Deborah at the State Archives. Liz was really helpful in that we found some of the early photos of JJ. This is JJ, his brother and sister. So we think it's circa 1936, because he's around 7 or 8 years old. And this is a Wheeling Lake Erie in Wheeling. And actually, JJ worked for a short period of time for the Wheeling and Lake Erie. He was a clerk, so he was handing orders up to crews. And he's also got a story we have on video at the Historical Society of his attempts, and he words it as attempts, to get the orders up to the crews using the hoops that they would, you know, tie the string with the order written on paper and you hold it up. And the idea is the crewman will stick their arm out while the train's moving and catch the orders. JJ never quite got that right, and he said they finally let him go because he kept he was the largest source of hoop expenditures on the Wheeling Lake Erie. They were made out of bamboo, so they were meant to break, but JJ kept breaking them. He never got the hang of it. So that was his only real experience as a professional railroader, and it wasn't with the B&O of all things. So JJ's growing up in Wheeling. He's growing up in Wheeling during the Great Depression, born in 1929. So it's an interesting time period to be running around with the camera and being a little kid. You've got the great industrial might of the Ohio River Valley at its peak. We haven't started World War II yet, at which point people running around with cameras get looked at real funny. And he's a kid, so he's got this air of innocence about him that lets him into places that normally would probably be off limits to grown-ups. So he's running around Wheeling, he's got his camera, and he's just snapping away. Wheeling has a great transit system, so he can run around the town. He gets to know the railroad crews, and he has access, eventually, to the B&O. You know, he gets these great shots of the EM1s that ran through Wheeling. And that's really what I focused on when I was, you know, starting out as an archivist here, because, again, biased towards the B&O. I had no idea about his Pennsy photography and his Pittsburgh and West Virginia photography, or his Wheeling and Lake Erie photography, or his nickel plate, or even the New York Central. This was actually probably one of the hardest things for us to research, because the New York Central lines into eastern Ohio to the coal fields were just kind of looked over by a lot of the railroad press at the time. And we started working on this book after I had started at the Barriger Library, and it's got 30,000 volumes of books and industry periodicals that go back to the 1820s to the present. And I tore my hair out trying to find authoritative sources on the history of the New York Central going into eastern Ohio, and what was the rationale, how did it get started. We eventually find it, but it was extremely difficult. I had an easier time picking up stuff on the Bentwood and Wheeling Connecting Railway than on the New York Central lines. And then also, JJ had some industrial railroad stuff. He actually worked at one of the steel mills in Wheeling, so he shot that. And then, of course, Ohio River Sand and Gravel was pretty much omnipresent in the area. And then he shot the transit. Selection of the photos kind of became the next problem we had to deal with. We had 10,000 pictures, and we had to pick ones that we could identify and we could create captions and were interesting. And we were also looking at what did he photograph more of. You know, we tried to divide the book up based on divisions of what he took. A lot of B&O, then Pennsy, then basically the railroads that wind up forming nickel plate through the mergers, and then New York Central being the last of the class ones in terms of quantity. And then he did some industrial stuff, and then he did some trolley stuff. So we wind up trying to pick pieces that, that all came out of that collection. And you can see, he's a self-taught photographer, but he's got a good eye for composition. You know, this is, you wouldn't think this was just a guy out of Wheeling, West Virginia. You'd think this was one of like the New York Times photographers in the 30s, or an Alfred Eisenstadt shot. The composition is great. He's got the women in the foreground, he's got the trolley in the background, you've got the holidays sign for the store and the, behind that. It's a very well put together shot. There's a lot going on, but it doesn't overwhelm you. And he's clearly focusing on the trolley. And this is a guy who did this without going to school to be a photographer. So we went through and started picking out things. The short version was, you know, first thing, we picked the ones that J.J. had picked. And J.J.'s rationale was basically what Vincent liked, Vincent Price would say. He knew what he liked, and he liked what he knew. So he had a large, he had a collection of 20 images that he had picked out before he passed away. He'd actually written the captions. And we used those. We did note in the notes which ones were his. I don't think WVU Press carried that over into the captions. I wish they had, because that was his physical imprint in the book. And then we were able to try and piece together text from articles he had written for trains. You know, Monsters of Mingo Junction was a famous article. He did some oral history work. Where he was interviewed, or he gave presentations to historical groups. We had that on tape. He had other images that had shown up individually in Trains Magazine and other magazines throughout 60s, 70s, and 50s that we were able to pull from to try and figure out other things. So we worked hard to try and capture as much information as we could from everything that JJ had left behind or that we could infer from things we saw in the picture. And sometimes we got to pick, and we were trying to pick things that were interesting to us. I have a different philosophy of what I find interesting than what Greg and Liz would pick. So we all kind of mixed things up. This is a shot that Greg likes, because Greg's into steam locomotives. I like steam locomotives, but I can't tell you all the technical details of the subclass. I would say, let me go get the reference book. Greg can just rattle that off. I would pick shots like this. This is Harry Truman in Wheeling during the 52 election, where he's stumping for Adlai Stevenson. Even though he wasn't running for office, Truman campaigned against Eisenhower for Stevenson and used, you know, it's essentially like, you know, Air Force One is a presence. They say that Air Force One is the ultimate home field advantage, so when the president's campaigning for someone else and shows up in a plane, that means something. In the 40s and 30s, and even into the early 50s, when the Ferdinand Magellan showed up in town, you went out and saw it, as the people of Wheeling very obviously did in this picture. I thought that was great. Greg was like, eh. And then I also thought these shots were interesting. Craig, Kordick and Company, which was a radio show on KDK out of Pittsburgh, they had a traveling road show where they took a van that the station owned and had put speakers on, and they loaded it on a B&O gondola and slapped it on the back of the train, and they did a traveling show down through the KDK listening area. That's another shot I thought was really neat. And that one we were kind of on the fence with. I don't think that one made it into the book exactly, but I thought it was great, and again, it's JJ taking pictures of trains that aren't necessarily technically oriented.
I reached Kordick. His dad was an engineer on B&O, so we got a railroad connection.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Cool. Now, here's one we always thought would make neat Christmas cards, but they didn't make it into the book. This is how you got your Christmas trees in Wheeling in 1940, I think this is 47. Came in the boxcars, and he had a couple of shots of that. really neat. It shows just the interface of the railroad and the community and how important railroads were until the interstate highway system supplanted them and surpassed them as the way people got things into their towns. And you know, something as you would think Christmas trees, well, you just go out and cut a Christmas tree or they'd be on the lot. No, they came in by railroad cars. And in fact, a bunch of Canadian railroad cars at that. And I think one's a Northern Pacific in the far background. That they're all bundled together, pre-cut, and off they went. There were a lot of images in the collection at the State Archives of railroaders. We used some of them in the calendar. We used a couple of them in the book. And the problem was with JJ passing away and taking his captions with him, we had all these images and we didn't know who the people were. So that is still something that if someone knows people on the Wheeling Division in it, that would be a project that if anyone wanted to work with them and get that stuff online, maybe people's descendants could say, oh, that's my great uncle or my grandfather. That would help us identify who these people were. Like I said, there are hundreds of pictures of railroaders at work. And that was something JJ would do. He'd get in the cab, say, can I take your picture, guys? He'd take pictures of the crew and then give them the prints. Unfortunately, he didn't write down on his own notes who all these people were. So again, the State Archives has all these pictures of West Virginia railroaders and very few captions. The ones we did use were the ones we actually could identify who the people were. Some we did go to the old chestnuts. This has been in trains. It's been in power. It's probably one of his most well-known photographs of the Moundsville, West Virginia station with the passenger train coming in. If you were to do a Google search of J.J. Young, this is probably one of the first pictures that's going to pop up. It's such a classic shot, even though it's been used, you got to use it. You know, we had to use it. And then we had the fancy shots in the roundhouse, which were great. And not something I had been exposed to. And we went ahead and brought them back out and used those. Not many people take pictures in the round. And if you look at the vast number of railroad photographs that have been taken in the history of photography being around railroads, very few people actually went into the roundhouse with their camera to take pictures, which is disappointing because you can, as you can see here, you can do some really neat things with light and the subject. If conditions are just right. And you can see the shafts of light coming in from the lamps, from the windows, and it kind of creates this glow in conjunction, mainly because there's so much crud in the air. I mean, that's another thing that people don't think about, is just how filthy roundhouses were. That may also be one reason why people didn't want to bring their brand new expensive professional camera in there. But there's a few, and they're really good, and you kind of wonder why didn't people go in more often. Particularly since I've heard stories where, you go to the yard guys and they're like, yeah, just don't get hurt and don't fall in one of the inspection pits, but you can walk around. And yet, very few people have taken roundhouse interior shots that I would say are worth using again. And again, this was JJ, a self-taught photographer. He also captures some really unique moments in addition to the presidential trips. This is the 1947 American Freedom Train. If you don't know the story behind the American Freedom Train, after World War II, several industrialists were kind of looking at polls and the American population was just retired. We just fought the Nazis and the Japanese, and everybody's coming home, and people want to get families started, they want commercial goods again, everyone's just kind of worn out, and the accomplishments of the country were being just kind of glossed over because everybody was focusing on the challenges we were dealing with after World War II. And Europe was unstable, Asia was unstable, and these guys were like, man, we can't afford for America to be unstable. So we kind of need to remind people why this is a good country, why we've done so much, and why we should be proud of everything we've done. So one of these guys was the head of General Electric, who happened to make diesel locomotives and had really good relationships with railroads. And they went to the U.S. government and said, we want to do this project where we showcase American history, American values, American civics, and we want to take it around the country, and we will bankroll the project, and will you support it? And the feds were like, sure. So that was the beginning of the first Freedom Train. And this is the shot in Wheeling. It's actually coming in on the Pennsylvania Railroad. J.J. shot a few images of the Pennsy compared to the B&O, but he was reliably shooting at the Pennsy Depot, mainly because you had interesting trains, and it was a central part of town. It was easy for him to get to. And in this case, he could get around the property in such a manner that he could get these shots without, you know, being in the Ohio River. So this shot actually is what we used for our cover. It was not my first choice. My first choice was a shot of the Bedwood Bridge. And there's a story why this is on the cover and the Bedwood Bridge shot isn't. We worked with the Western University Press. They have an art department. And we worked with the editor there, and we had submitted a title that was the more general, because the book is not entirely Wheeling. It's the Wheeling area. Because there's stuff in Bel Air, there's stuff in Dillondale, there's stuff in Benwood. You know, it's not entirely Wheeling. But they said, no, let's just focus on Wheeling, because that's the majority of the book. It's a shorter title, it's precise. Okay. So then the art director is working with us, and says, what do you guys want to use for your cover? So we sent some suggestions. My first choice was the Benwood Bridge. And he says, it just doesn't pop. And he's right, it didn't pop out. There wasn't a lot of contrast, but, you know, if there's one thing that the Wheeling area kind of focused on was Benwood for the B&O and the crossing of the Ohio River. That was really the key for the railroads being there. It's where you cross the river, and Benwood was where you got to that river crossing and you served all the industries on the Ohio River side. So he said, I don't like that. This is one that I thought would be really good. And it's a shot of Steubenville. And it's great. It's a wonderful shot of Steubenville, Ohio. And I had to point out, the title says Wheeling. The picture is of Steubenville. And you know it's Steubenville because there's the Pennsylvania Railroad sign on the station with the keystone that says Steubenville. Can't use that one. He's like, good point. So he went and picked another one. He said, what do you think about this one? It's got great contrast, there's a crowd, there's people, it's interesting, it's unique. I said, okay, perfect. And that's how this shot became our cover shot. And it is a very striking photograph, and it has grown on me. Even though it's from what I call the other firm or brand X, it is a great picture. And I'm glad that we had a professional art person look at it and say, no, this is what you want to showcase your book. Some other things that didn't make the whole project, he had a lot of shots of the Spino rail grinder train. I mean, he really shot a lot of this train. There are like 20 pictures of this one train. And I think probably because, one, it was the only train running that day, and if he was outside with the camera, by golly, there wasn't anything else running. This is what we're going to photograph. So he spent an entire roll on this thing. I think it's interesting because there's not a lot of early shots, early mid-century shots of maintenance of way equipment operating. So I was kind of fond of them. But we didn't need 80 of them or 25 of them. We did get a series of shots of a telegraph operator or a clerk in the Wheeling area that J.J. knew throughout his lifetime. And he was good friends enough with him, and the guy stayed in the same position long enough that even after J.J. moved to New York and was teaching at the Binghamton, at the Community College in Binghamton, he came back and he would hang out with this guy. Now, something about J.J., J.J. did not like diesels. He really didn't like the B&O diesels. And that was one reason why he kind of stopped photographing Wheeling, because once the steam engines left Wheeling, he wasn't as interested. Now, he still shot diesels, but he was really disappointed with the change. And it was one reason he didn't regret moving on. Because Wheeling was one of the last spots in the country that you could still get steam locomotives. So when that ends, you know, there's really nothing holding him there. And he gets the job offer at Binghamton, and so he moves up. But he's good enough, he's still good friends with the people who work here. He comes back, this is a shot in the 60s of handing up orders. This is a better shot than the gentleman. I forget his name, he's in the book.
Paul Maxwell.
Thank you, Mr. Maxwell. In his office, he's got his phone, he's getting orders, or he's either getting or transmitting orders for a train. And of course, when you hoop up orders to the front end, you gotta hoop up orders to the back end. Because while it's really nice that the guys driving the train have the paperwork, the guy who's actually in charge of the paperwork should probably have a set of the orders too. So he's photographed a lot of Mr. Maxwell. And we put some of the shots in there. There are still more at the State Archives. You could probably do an entire photo essay on Mr. Maxwell's career from the time J.J. knew him and was on the railroad, and they would come back and visit in the summers. Double-headed steam. This was my preference for the cover shot on the approach to the Bentwood Bridge. EM1, I think that's a Pacific in the back. I loved it, but it just didn't have the sizzle for the art department. He did come back. He did photograph when things weren't as good in Wheeling. This is the same station that the Freedom Train was photographed in 1947. We're now into the 60s, and passenger traffic has dropped dramatically on the Pensee. And this is what you're getting through Wheeling at the Pensee PRR station. You can see already financial condition is not necessarily the best. There's a lot of weeds growing up in the middle of the tracks now that used to be completely clear. Steam exhaust was a help with that. The various outcastings didn't help support a lot of plant life along the railroad. And you can see that there's already a market change. He did, and this is actually something that was new to me, he did spend some time in Ohio, on the Ohio side of the river. He'd have a friend take him across, or he'd hitchhike or get a crew to take him across. One thing you could tell if it was J.J. Young, if you were photographing out in the field, there'd be this guy in work boots and jeans and have this big paper sack. The big paper sack was his camera bag, which, kind of eccentric, but if you think about it, nobody's going to think you're going to have a camera in there. You think, well, the guy's got lunch or groceries, so there's a method. He did shoot the Pittsburgh and West Virginia, the Wheeling and Lake Erie, the Nickel Plate, and there are even some N&W shots after the Nickel Plate was bought by N&W, or merged into N&W in the late 60s. We didn't put those in, mainly because we were looking at a sweet spot for our audience, and early 60s is about as far as we wanted to go. Because really, the steam shots were most interesting. There's a lot of passionate steam people, and we were hoping they would buy that book, and they did. And of course, the rarest shots of the collection are the New York Central shots. He only made, so far as I know, about one trip over to the New York Central's operation. And he photographed it quite extensively during that trip. But that was it. Partially because it didn't last as long as other areas that he photographed. And it wasn't as easy for him to get to. Not having a car, you needed a car to get to Dillonvale, or you needed somebody with a car to get to Dillonvale for him. And he could only get there when he could get there. And he made use of the time he had in photographing. Now this should be familiar. This is the bridge just up the river here. And at this time, it's nickel plate era, so we're already into the 60s. But we did put it in there, the nickel plate diesels. I have a soft spot for the nickel plate, even though I'm a B&O guy. I like the paint scheme. But the biggest problem with all of this was we get these images, and we didn't know any captions. So, you know, we spent a lot of time at the state archives, and we spent a lot of time gathering what information we could. And at this point, it was really fortunate that I had changed jobs partway through this process, because I now had access to the Barriger collection. So this is actually my first day on the job, 5 years ago, almost 5 years and 1 month ago. My office is nowhere near that neat now. But we were able to leverage the Barriger collections to fill in a lot of the gaps, particularly the history. Greg, who unfortunately wasn't with us today, has a near encyclopedic technical knowledge of railroad equipment. And that's Greg's thing. You know, people memorize stats for baseball players, steam locomotive stats, and other equipment stats. That's Greg's thing. And he maintains a personal library that rivals the Barriger's collection on equipment. And that was really where Greg was able to say, nope, here's the specific locomotive. It actually was modified by the time JJ took his picture, and you can tell why, because this car is from this year. That's another thing. Greg's a car guy more than I'm a car guy. I'm sorry if people are car people and they're horribly disappointed that there's an American male who's not a car guy, but I'm just not a car guy. I can't tell a 56 Cadillac from a 57. And then Liz was able to fill in all the gaps on JJ's life. We knew what JJ had talked about personally. We knew what he had published in articles. We knew what he had talked about with the Historical Society. Liz was able to fill in a lot of the stories that he didn't commit to paper or to videotape. And between her, JJ's son, and his other family members, we were able to fill in a lot of JJ's early life. The Thanksgiving story, he actually had on videotape. And Liz was able to reinforce it and confirm it. Liz also told us stories about, he had a friend in Wheeling who lost his legs when they were kids. Their hobby, you know, they jumped trains. They would jump slow moving freight trains and ride them for a little bit and then jump off. Stupid stuff kids do. Well, JJ knew you had to jump on at a certain point in the car, because if you missed it, you'd have enough time that you could get your legs out of the way and you would lose those legs. Well, his friend tried to jump without enough time. He missed it and he lost the leg. We didn't know that story. Liz was able to fill us in on that. We were also able to get a lot of maps. The Wheeling area is a very complicated area to look at, and if you're not from around here and you didn't grow up with the railroads in the area, you really need a lot of reference points. So we were able to bring in as many maps as we could. This is actually a Pennsylvania Railroad map, and I'm sorry it's not bigger, because it is a really great map. It's from 1905. It's in the Barriger Library, but it shows every railroad in the Wheeling area as of 1905, including like the industrial lines. And that was a huge help to me, because I'm not from around here. I have to be kind of a generalist, so I needed to learn as much as I could, as quickly as I could, to help make the book come to life. And this was a big help. Greg actually went to the various courthouses and county office buildings on both sides of the river, and he was collecting maps from the municipalities. And unfortunately, not all of them were able to be used, but it helped us when we were writing the narrative text of all the chapters. So we started this in 2006, and we kind of bounced back and forth and bounced back and forth. And then in 2014, we said, you know, let's try a press. And we were prepared for disappointment. And the next thing you know, a year after we make the presentation at WVU Press, it's here. They did sell out the first printing, which means they're happy with us. They have not tried to strong arm us into writing a second book, which is fine, because I've got another project on tap right now. But it has been a fun book to have out. We've gotten generally positive response. The only thing we probably would have changed is, and it would have made the book a lot more expensive, we would have probably upped the quality of the paper they used to make the photographs come out a little better. But they had to make a decision, you know, price point was $40, and they had to make trade-offs. So, you know, no author will ever be happy with how their book comes out from the publisher because they have this perfect idea. But generally, if that happens, you wind up getting a catalog that costs $120 a copy and sits on the shelf, as opposed to a $40 book that people actually buy. So that's been out. It's been out now for over a year. I do have the one copy. We're going to bring more. Unfortunately, Greg had some work commitments that came up at the last minute. He wasn't able to bring them with him. They are available from Amazon, from the press itself, and from the B&O Railroad Historical Society. If you would like to buy from any of those, I'm going to shamelessly shill the B&O Historical Society, because sales from the company store support our archive works. And we do have one copy here available for the raffle, and a copy of the 2007 calendar we did with the Historical Society. We also have extras of those at the B&O Historical Society if you'd like to pick those up. That's all I've got at the moment. Does anyone have any questions for me? Yes?
When you refer to Nimble Clay,
yes.
What do you mean?
That actually was the New York, Chicago, and St. Louis Railroad. And its marketing slogan from its early origins was the Nickel Plate Road, which was used to imply well-built, well-run, tight schedule. And for many, many years, it was held as a subsidiary of the New York Central, because it parallels the New York Central from Buffalo, New York to Chicago, Illinois.
So that was actually the rail line?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, God, I thought maybe you were referring to the locomotive.
No, that was the actual railroad, yeah. And early on, you see it in their passenger timetables and in their advertising. You know, ship your freight on the Nickel Plate Road, fastest route between Buffalo and Chicago, or fastest route between New York and the Midwest.
That's Nickel Plate.
That,
you know where that?
It comes from in the 19th century. You had something that was nickel plated. It was sturdy. It was shiny.
Oh, okay.
It wasn't gaudy. You know, like gold-plated or gilded,
yeah.
But nickel-plated, something's like, this isn't working, but it's really nice thing. And in fact, if you are interested, in the fall, a very nice steam locomotive shows up in the Cuyahoga Valley Fall National Park on the Cuyahoga Scenic Railway. Nickel Plate 765, she's my favorite steam locomotive that runs. Support those folks that run out of Fort Wayne, Indiana. And you know, buy a shirt and take pictures if you don't want to ride. But it is just when you see the locomotive running, you kind of get what they meant, because it runs like a Swiss watch. She's great.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Do you have questions?
You say we're printed?
We're at least in the second now. We sold out the first within a year, actually less than a year. They sold out the first edition by I think Christmas time. They had sold the first edition of last year, and now we're at least in the second edition right now. So if you have a first edition, first printing, you have a book that is sold well, and one that you cannot get anymore, because now we're on the
3619 right now on Amazon, 3619.
There you go.
Yeah.
One another question.
Sure.
This JJ,
mm-hmm.
it seems kind of unusual to me that a child would have a camera, and especially in that.
He had a camera from when he was 8 years old on, but it, you know, it was like one of those cheap Kodak Brownie cameras.
Okay, but his parents bought it.
Yeah.
Okay.
And part of that was because he was a sickly kid, so he didn't get out much.
Okay.
And it's like, you know, give him something, and they got him a Brownie camera. And he liked trains, so he grabbed it and take it to it.
And what year did you
passed in 2004. Yes, sir.
It's amazing. I've seen the book. I got the book out of the library. It's a wonderful book. I've known her for 41 years.
Thank you.
I worked for Norfolk Southern and Conrail and Penn Central. But back then, you could do this stuff. I got the tail end of them. You could go on and ride the right away and everything. But now, they got locked down so tight, especially since 9/11. It's very sad if you're an active rail fan or railroad in this day and age.
It's a lot more difficult. The only way you could do what J.J. did is to have the explicit permission of the railroad itself and the paperwork with you.
The lawyers are afraid of all that now. They went to Bruce to report the people on the right way.
I'll tell you, you have better luck with short lines than the big ones.
Yeah.
But you can still sometimes get away with it. I take pictures of trains. My rule of thumb is I don't go on the property line. Generally, if you stay off the property, I have never had a problem with a crew calling me in because I'm off the property line. Now, I tend also to photograph in spots in the St. Louis area that are known rail fan spots, so I'm expected. I have a scanning radio, so I can monitor the trains to help with my photography. And generally, if you show up somewhere unexpected, you get called in. If you're in a spot that's well known, you get a wave. They know you're going to be there. The guy who trained them or the gal who trained them told them you're going to get your picture taken here. In fact, one year when I was still working at NASA, we had the almost government shutdown of 2011, where they made the midnight deal on a Friday night. Well, they had shut down everything at my office. So it was going to take 6 hours to get the computers back up. So they told us, don't even bother coming in until around 1. And the Barnum & Bailey surface train was coming out of Baltimore. And it was going to go right by where I lived. A mile away from where my condominium was. And it was on the way to work. So I just parked the car in the marked train station lot. And I had the radio on, and I'm waiting. And he was going to leave Baltimore after all the commuter trains had left. And the dispatcher says, okay, fellas, y'all ready to get your picture taken today? So they know. They know you're going to, if you got the circus train, you're going to see people with cameras. It's just a fact of life. But, yeah, don't surprise them and stay off the property line. Generally, you're going to be fine. You might have a local police officer who's going to ask what you're doing, but the railroad guys know. Any other questions? Okay, well, thank you all very much for coming out on a very pleasant evening.